off to?
I'm going to find God.
Ah, I see. Well, dinner's at 6. Don't be late.
Good morning, church. Just had Twinkies in the park with God, and he's much younger than I expected him to be. It's my second favorite line. The favorite line is when he comes home and mom says, "So did you find him?" And he said, "God is a woman, mom." And she's got the most beautiful smile. We hope that in your day you find God especially. We hope you experience God as you've come to worship this morning. We want to welcome each of you. If there are guests in our midst this morning, we are glad that you have found your way to worship here at Milton UMC, and we invite you to remain with us. Following worship, we'll offer a time of food and hospitality, either in the entryway or as well in the fellowship hall following worship. And for those of you who may worship here more regularly, if there's somebody here you don't recognize today, well, why don't you introduce yourself and make somebody else feel welcome. So once again, welcome as we've come to worship God on this beautiful Sunday morning. Jan?
Spirit, place, set on.
You may be seated. Well, now comes the hardest thing you'll do all day. Oh, listen to you groaning. Wow. But you know what? Y'all did it a couple weeks ago, so I know you can do it this time as well. So our next song is actually in the Faith We Sing. You're going to see the words, but it might be a little easier if you want to take a look. It's on 2174, and this is a song that we're going to sing as a round, and it's in three parts. So we're going to have part one be here, and part two is going to be right in the middle, and then part three is going to be here. And you all can be whatever. You can join whatever one you want over here because you're kind of like special, you know. So one, two, and three. And the first part is, what does the Lord require of you? You see it there. And then the second part will come in with justice, kindness. And then the third part is to seek justice. So we're going to go through each of the parts. And then we'll put it all together. So let's do the first one, and we're just going to be this group over here.
What does the Lord require of you? What does the Lord require of you?
And that's all you have to do. Isn't that easy? Isn't that great? Okay. Now, the middle part is going to be number two. Justice, kindness, walk humbly with your God. Let's try part two.
Justice, kindness, walk humbly with your God.
Isn't that beautiful? Don't they do a nice job with that? Isn't that good? So that's the second part. And that's the only part that you have to sing. And then the third part, to seek justice and love kindness and walk humbly with your God. Let's try the third part.
To seek justice and love kindness and walk humbly with your God.
Very nice. All right. So we're going to start, and the first part is going to start here, and then you're going to keep singing it. And then on our cue, we're going to bring in number two, and then you're going to keep singing the second part, and then we're going to bring in number three. And you'll keep singing. And at some point, we're all going to be singing our parts. And we're going to do that through a couple of times until the Spirit tells us we're going to bring it to a close. How does that sound? Does that sound good? All right. What does the Lord require of you? Let's sing.
What does the Lord require of you? What does the Lord require of you?
I invite, if you wish, to turn to page 3 in your worship bulletin, or our slides behind us will allow you to respond. Friends, let us share together who we are as a church and these touchstones of Milton United Methodist Church. Please join me. As Christ's church, this is what we are about: Scripture, that it may be taught and shared; prayer, to draw us close to God and one another; connection, that we get to know one another beyond saying hello; service, to move from sitting in church to serving beyond; grace, to
to accept God's love and mercy because God wants us to have it. And now we pray to the prayer of the church. For this reason, I bow my knees before God, from whom every family in heaven and on earth and heaven is named, that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant you to be strengthened through the power of through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being grounded and rooted in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever.
Join me up front.
Come on up. Have a seat. Come on up.
Ooh. Good morning, Addison.
Hi.
How are you guys? Good morning. So, I have a question. Are you scared of anything? No, you're not scared of anything? Is anybody scared of spiders? There's somebody at my house scared of spiders, because they kind of crawl. Are you scared of spiders? No? There's somebody at my house that's scared of thunderstorms. Are you scared of thunderstorms when it gets really loud? No? You guys are really brave. Wow. You guys are not, are you scared? Is anybody scared of monsters under their bed? No? You guys must have really safe houses. When one of my kids was little, they were afraid of monsters under their bed, and I had to tell them that there were no monsters under their bed, because there are none. No? Do you know why there's no monsters under their bed? Because somebody keeps them safe. Who do you think would keep them safe? Who keeps you safe? Does Mom keep you safe? And Dad keeps you safe? Yeah? You know what? God keeps you safe, too. You know, when maybe you get scared of those spiders, or the thunder gets really loud, or anything else that makes you scared, you know what? God's right there. And we're told over and over in the Bible, do not be afraid, for God is with us. So maybe when you get a little bigger, there's going to be something that you're a little afraid of. Maybe it's going to be going to school for the first time, you get a little nervous, right? Or maybe you're learning to ride your bike and it's a little scary the first time. But you know what? Mom and Dad are there to keep you safe. But you know, God's always there to keep us safe. Always. Because God loves you so much. All the time. That's pretty cool, huh? That's pretty cool. So I'm going to say a little prayer and then you can say amen with me at the end, okay? Dear God, thank you for loving me. Thank you for keeping me safe. Thank you for making me not afraid. Help me know that you are with me all of the time. One, two, three. Amen. Good job, guys. Good job. Awesome.
Well, we have some very fearless children.
I know.
That's awesome. That's wonderful. And who needs socks to come to church? I mean, really. We're a very comfortable place here. Our children bring us into a time of prayer each week, actually, and by their presence and by being in that moment. And so today we have a chance to be in that moment as well, of coming before God in prayer. And I would be privileged to ask at this time the joys and thanksgivings that you might wish to share before God and one another today. What is a joy in your life that you would share? Yes, Judy.
My mom has come home from the rehab center and is now ready for her apartment, and she's doing very well. We are so blessed.
And her back surgery has alleviated her pain. Wonderful. Well, it's a joy, and that she's home already. That's really quite remarkable. So good for her. Please please share with her that our congregation has been praying for her and with her throughout this entire ordeal, and we're grateful and praise God for her her healing. Thank you, Judy. Other praises this morning? Yes, Benita. So Benita is leaving for Florida on Tuesday, and she's expressing this as a joy, which I, for you it is. Good. Well, as long as you remember to come back, that's fine. You will. So wonderful. Well, safe travels to you and blessings on your journey. Yes, Sherry.
Well, I'm going to try that. We just got back from Florida.
Well, that is a joy. Good. Well, Jim and Sherry, welcome back. And we have quite a Florida contingent, apparently. But welcome home. We pray that you had a wonderful winter, and we're glad that you are back home. Yes, Betty. Wonderful. Betty offering praise for a friend that had some times of unrest in the hospital. She is back home, and she's a dear friend, and we are trusting that God has graced her with being in this new place. And so, amen. Thank you so much, Betty. Yes, Dory. Dory is having grandchild number 13. Well, congratulations. Wonderful to you. And, you know, it gives me an opportunity to welcome you. Dory, of course, was part of our congregation, has remained a part of our congregation, but she and Kevin moved and now have moved back, and so you are back with us, and we are grateful for that. And congratulations on the newest member of your family. Wonderful. Yes, Lori. If you didn't hear Lori's prayer, Dan, of course, has been in the hospital. He had lung surgery. They had identified lung cancer. And following the surgery and the tests, they told him this week that they believe that he is 90% sure he is cancer-free. The surgery has been quite an ordeal. He's home. Lori made him stay home today, even though he was trying to get here. But please share our prayers with him as we keep him in our thoughts. So thank you, Lori. Yes, Heather. Is that a fact? It is. Well, World Down Syndrome Day is on what? What day is it? Tuesday?
Yeah.
Tuesday. And it happens to be Peyton's birthday. And I think he's. Is he there he is. Wonderful. Peyton, it's so great that he's here today. This is birthday number what?
Six.
You know, it's a bummer that he's growing up because he was in our preschool and it was such a joy to have him here. And now he's off almost ready for, you know, high school. So anyway, well, happy birthday, Peyton. That's awesome. That's awesome. Great. Other joys this morning? Yes. Deanna, now take it easy. So Joe is also having his birthday. Joe plays bass in our 10:30 worship team, and I've been told that it's his birthday. So you can wish him happy birthday, but if he resists that, it's Deanna's fault. Kind of you to remember him, however. He's probably listening. He's in the back probably warming up even as we speak. So, friends, we know also that as we come to worship, there are those who are in need of our prayers and our cares and concern. And so I would invite the concerns that you might share this morning, and a few have been shared with me thus far. Mike Gottschalk had a heart procedure this past week, and he's home and he's doing well, but they identified some things that they want to continue to monitor and some further healing. And so we pray that Mike will continue to be on that journey of recovery. Alice Godding has gone back to the hospital again yesterday. She's been back and forth and with heart difficulties, and she just can't get back to a point where she's comfortable being at home. I would ask your prayers for Dave Schultz. I know parts of his family are here this morning. It's great that you're with us. Dave remains hospitalized at St. Mary's Hospital in Madison. And I missed an earlier joy. I don't see him right at the moment, but Archie Barron is back with us. There he is. He's right there. Archie is back with us, and blessings to you. Archie was away for some time healing and recuperating, and it's great to have you back with us today, Archie. He got back just in time to cheer on the Badgers to a basketball victory yesterday. Amen. See how I snuck that one right in there? Are there other concerns that you would lift this morning? Yes, Betty. A fellow bowler of Betty just had triple bypass surgery. Thank you. What's his first name?
Mike.
Thank you, Betty. Other concerns to lift this morning? Yes, Joe. What's her first name?
Wilva.
Wilva? Okay. Wilva is a friend of the Roberts, and she is...
She started treatments Tuesday.
Okay.
Treatment Tuesday, because the other
wasn't working. Okay. A new form of treatments for her. And thank you, Joe, for remembering her this morning. Yes, Kim. Kim's friend Jenny, whose father has been diagnosed with cancer, and praying for that family during this time. Thank you, Kim. Let us bring these prayers and the prayers that we have not spoken aloud before God this morning, shall we? Gracious God, as we enter into this sanctuary today, we do so mindful that we bring all the experiences of our lives with us. And you have heard the joys expressed this morning, God, the ability to laugh and to share with one another, to tell stories about the goodness in our lives, and to bolster one another in hope and faith. And it is such a privilege, God, that you have given us the church for that to be a place, for hope to be born and to be renewed. We are grateful, God, for the ability to travel, to see friends, to reunite with family, to simply explore the beauty of this created world, oh God. For the variety of seasons that we can enjoy, winter and summer, and know that you go with us wherever we might journey. We thank you, O God, for the sound of children, the presence of families, the love of parents, the care of grandparents, and the birth of a grandchild, the celebration of a birthday. God, we also pray this day for those who are in need. For Jesus always came to us in our need. For those who needed to be healed, as we will hear in our words of Scripture today. For those who need consolation or strength, perhaps encouragement, or to have their fears relieved. God, may we be aware of your presence, which is unchanging and constant, so that we can lean into your care when we are most in need. You've heard the names of so many lifted up today, God, and now we take this moment to lift to you those prayers silently that live in our hearts this day. And Lord, would you hear us now as we come before you praying in one voice, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Friends, let us now continue our worship by bringing before God an offering of our tithes and our gifts. Today also is the third Sunday of the month in which we have a chance to be in partnership with our missionary Paul Webster in Zambia. And so your loose change offerings will be welcomed. Our children and perhaps a couple of other volunteers might be willing to take these cans around to receive those offerings as well.
You can help me.
God, as we see these children come, they have the same joy as they receive the offering as they do when they leave it at your altar. May our hearts be transformed as well, that we might see this as a time of joy, that we might place these gifts before you, that as this church prays for your wisdom, we can use them to bring the light of your gospel into our community, into our homes, and into our world. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
And would you join me in singing Be Thou My Vision?
Today, a story of healing in four parts. First, from the Old Testament's prophet Isaiah.
Say to those who are panicking, be strong, don't fear. Here's your God coming with vengeance, with divine retribution. God will come to save you. Then the eyes of the blind will be opened, and the ears of the deaf will be cleared. Then the lame will leap like the deer, and the tongue of the speechless will sing. Waters will spring up in the desert, and streams in the wilderness. The burning sand will become a pool, and the thirsty ground fountains of water.
Thank you, Katie. A story of healing, part two, from the Gospel of John. Walking down the street, Jesus saw a man who had been blind since birth. And his disciples asked, Rabbi, who sinned? This man or his parents, causing him to be born blind? And Jesus said, you're asking the wrong question. You're looking for someone to blame. There's no such cause-effect here. Look instead for what God can do. We need to be energetically at work for the one who sent me here, working while the sun shines. When night falls, the workday is over. For as long as I am in the world, there is plenty of light. I am the world's light. Jesus said this, and then he spit in the dust. He made a clay paste with the saliva, and he rubbed the paste on the blind man's eyes and said, go, wash at the pool of Siloam. Siloam means sent. And so the man went and washed, and then he saw. Soon the town was buzzing. His relatives and those who year after year after year had seen the blind man begging were saying, isn't this the man we knew who sat here and begged? And others said, it's him all right. But others said, it's not the same man at all. It just looks like him. And he said, it's me. I am the very one.
And then they said, how did your eyes get opened? Well, a man named Jesus made paste and he rubbed it on his eyes and he told me, go to Siloam and wash. And I did what he said. And when I washed, I saw. So where is he? I don't know. Well, then they marched the man to the Pharisees. They were the leaders. Now, it happened to be that the day that Jesus made the paste and healed the man's blindness was the Sabbath day, the day of no work, of rest. Well, the Pharisees grilled Jesus again. In fact, they grilled the man again and how he had come to see. And he said, well, Jesus put a clay paste on my eyes, and I washed, and now I see. And some of the Pharisees said, well, obviously this man can't be from God. He doesn't keep the Sabbath, referring to Jesus. And others said, but how can a bad man do miracles? How can he do God-revealing things like this? So there was a split in their ranks. And then they came back to the blind man and they said, well, you're the expert. He opened your eyes. What do you say about this man, Jesus? The man said, he's a prophet. Well, the Jews didn't believe it. They didn't believe the man was blind to begin with. So they called the parents of the man who was now bright-eyed with sight. And they asked them, is this your son, the one that you say was born blind? So how is it that he now sees? And his parents said, we know that he is our son. And we know that he was born blind. But we don't know how he now sees. We haven't a clue about who opened his eyes. Why don't you ask him? He's a grown man, and he can speak for himself. His parents were talking like this because they were intimidated by the Jewish leaders who had already decided that anyone who took a stand that this was the Messiah would be kicked out of the meeting place, which is why the parents said, well, ask him, he's a grown man. Well, they called the man back a second time, the man who had been blind, and they told him, give credit to God. We know that this man, Jesus, is an imposter. And the man said, I know nothing about that one way or the other. But I know one thing for sure. I was blind, and now I see. And they said, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? And the man said, I have told you over and over and over again, but you haven't listened. Why do you want to hear it again? Are you so eager to become his disciples? With that, they jumped all over him. You might be a disciple of that man, but we are disciples of Moses. We know for sure that God spoke to Moses, but we have no idea where this man Jesus even comes from. And then the man says, this is amazing. You claim to know nothing about him, but the fact is, he opened my eyes. It's well known that God isn't at the beck and call of sinners, but listens carefully to anyone who lives in reverence and does his will. That someone has opened the eyes of a man who had been born blind and now sees has been never heard of, ever. If this man didn't come from God, then he wouldn't be able to do anything. And they said to him, you're nothing but dirt. How dare you take that tone with us? Then they threw him out in the street. Well, Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, and they went and found him. And he asked him, do you believe in the Son of Man? And the man said, well, point him out to me so that I can believe in him. And then Jesus said, you're looking right at him. Don't you recognize my voice? And the man said, Master, I believe. And he worshiped him. And then Jesus said, I came into the world to bring everything into the clear light of day, making all the distinctions clear, so that those who have never seen will see, and those who have made a great pretense of seeing will be exposed as blind. And some Pharisees overheard him and said, so are you calling us blind? And Jesus said, well, if you really were blind, you'd be blameless. But since you claim to see everything so well, you're accountable for every fault and failure. A story of healing, part 3. The blind man as a guide. We're all alike, really. And you know how? We're all alike because we all have a need that we need to bring to Jesus. This man's need was not only his blindness, but it was spiritual. He needed acceptance. He needed to know that somebody cared. He needed to know that God cared. And Jesus filled that need. Jesus fills that need in all of our lives. So when Jesus met that need for this blind man, it made a difference in his life. His neighbors, who formerly knew the man that was blind, well, what did they say? Well, this isn't the blind man, is it? And somebody said, well, oh, yes, it is. And others said, no, it's not the blind man. It just looks like him. And the man himself said, wait a minute. It is me. I should know who I am. But the tragedy is that he had been overlooked. And that's why they didn't recognize him. The physical change may have been small from the outside. His eyes were closed and now they were open. How did they suddenly not know a man whose eyes were opened? Because they didn't notice him when his eyes were shut. But there had been a definite change in this man who had been blind and now saw. Not a big one physically, but it was very real. Something definitely happened. This man who had been blind was now running around. He was seeing. He was talking to people. He was different. And they noticed it. You know, if you've had a genuine conversion experience, it ought to make a change. When we become Christians, when we follow God, there should be some obvious difference in our lives, shouldn't there? There was a story of a little boy, a young boy, a youth, who had been converted to the faith, and then he went off for a week of camp. It wasn't a church camp. It was a community camp run by a group in town. And after the trip, he came home following a week and he said to his mother, we were there a whole week and not one of them found out that I had just become a Christian. And isn't that too often the case? These people asked questions not just about the blind man, but they asked questions about Jesus. Where is the man who did this? Tell us about him. And so the man who had received healing became the one who had the opportunity to tell the story. And they were going to build their idea about Jesus based on the story of the man whose blindness had been cured. Isn't it interesting how God uses us in that way? Because that was worth noticing, he was worth noticing, and because his story was worth noticing, Jesus was worth noticing. And in truth, that's really the only thing the world has to go on, isn't it? The stories that we, who have been healed and given sight by Jesus, are now able to share. There's a couple of mistakes we can make as people of faith. The first one is to say that we know everything already, which is neither biblical nor true. The other is to say that since we have become a Christian, all of our problems are gone. Everything is sweetness and peace and light. But we know that's not true either. The man still didn't know why he was born blind. Think about that. That answer was never given. Jesus only told him what he was going to do with his condition, with his blindness. And what did he say? He was going to glorify God. The man didn't know why Jesus picked him out on that afternoon among all the people who probably needed to be healed. People say, I don't know how to talk about what God has done for me. Well, if we're like that man, the thing to do is just to share it. He just told what had happened to him. To the best of ability, he explained how Jesus had come into his life and helped him see. He didn't embellish it. He didn't make it sound fancy. With beautiful, picturesque words, he just told the story. Friends, people are interested in your story. They're interested in our story. People who have never heard, people who have never set foot inside a church, people who are afraid to do so. They want to know our story. It doesn't have to be embellished. It just has to be shared. They're interested in our story because they want to know how we're different, how we have been changed. Not how we are better than, but how we have been changed because Jesus has come to us and healed us. The man who had been genuinely converted because his sight had been restored said, whether Jesus is a sinner or not because he healed on the Sabbath and broke your rules, I don't know. One thing I do know, I was blind and now I see. And one thing I know, my life would not be what it is today if it hadn't been for Jesus. A story of healing. Part 4. The child as a guide. This is a story about a group of children, school-age children, in a classroom. They went to school every day and they did their work and they tried to do what their teacher told them to do. Well, one day their teacher, Mrs. Jones, told them, I have to go down to the office for a few minutes. And while I'm gone, I want you to stay here in your seats and work quietly on that worksheet I gave you. There shouldn't be any talking and no getting up and no moving around the room. And so Mrs. Jones left the classroom, and they could hear the clip-clop of her shoes as she walked down the hallway toward the office. And just like any student at Milton East or West or Consolidated or Harmony, they wanted to do exactly what their teacher had told them. So they all focused on their worksheets, and they all resisted the urge to talk with their friends. And the classroom was very quiet, except for the sounds of everyone's pencils writing the words to the answers on their worksheets. And then suddenly, the silence was broken by a cell phone ringing in the fourth row. Oh, you can't plan that, can you? In this case, it wasn't broken by a cell phone. It was broken by a loud cough. It was Brandon. He was a new kid in class. And he kept coughing and coughing until his face turned red. Was Brandon okay? Was there something wrong with him? Did he need help? Everyone in the class looked at Brandon and then they looked at each other. Nobody wanted to disappoint or disobey Mrs. Jones by getting up out of their seats or calling the teacher next door for help. And then one girl in the class, Anna, finally spoke up. She said, Brandon, are you okay? Brandon didn't answer. He was coughing so hard that he couldn't even catch his breath enough to answer Anna. We have to help him, Anna said. Shh, the other kid said. Be quiet. Do you want to get in trouble? So Anna jumped out of her seat and she went over to Brandon. Sit down, Anna, the other kid said. But Anna didn't listen.
She patted Brandon firmly on the back a few times, the way her mom did when somebody was coughing really hard. But that didn't seem to help. So she ran to the classroom sink to get a cup of water for Brandon. And Brandon took a few sips of the water, and eventually his cough died down. "Thanks, Anna," he said. Well, just then the class heard the clip-clop, clip-clop of Mrs. Jones's shoes walking back from the office toward their classroom. And as Mrs. Jones came in the door, as children are wont to do, they said, "Mrs. Jones, Anna was talking and got out of her chair and while you were gone." They couldn't wait to tattle on Anna, even though Anna had talked and gotten out of her seat only to help Brandon. And before Mrs. Jones could scold Anna, Brandon spoke up. "Mrs. Jones," Brandon said, "I got a bad cough while you were gone, and Anna was helping me. She wasn't being bad. She was just being a good friend." May God add blessing to the hearing of this holy word. Amen.
Go peaceably, looking upon the hearts of others with the same compassion that Christ has shown us. Trust that he is able to open your eyes, enabling us to walk by faith in his name. Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.